Welcome to the patient education video for kidney and/or pancreas transplants. You are here today to be evaluated for a kidney and/or pancreas transplant. This video is designed to provide you with information about transplantation. Today, we will review the facts you will need to determine whether transplantation is right for you. As we review this information, you may want to make notes or jot down questions to ask your transplant team. You will receive a patient education guide that explains transplantation in detail and will be a long-term reference guide for you through the phases of transplantation. You can add information and contact numbers to this guide. It is important to bring your patient education guide with you for every clinic visit and when you are admitted to the hospital for your transplant. Portions of this guide will be used during your inpatient stay to teach you about medications and post-transplant care. You are here today to be evaluated for a kidney transplant. Let's take a closer look at what functions the kidneys perform. The basic functions of the kidneys are to filter poisons out of your blood and to regulate water balance. Some of you may also be here to be evaluated for a pancreas transplant. Let's take a closer look at the functions the pancreas performs. The basic functions of the pancreas are to secrete digestive juices and to secrete insulin, which assists in the regulation of blood sugar. Pancreas transplants may be helpful for patients who have type 1 diabetes, indicating their pancreas has lost its ability to make insulin and won't ever be able to make insulin again. There are three types of pancreas transplants: simultaneous pancreas and kidney, also known as SPK, pancreas after kidney transplant, or PAK, and pancreas alone, referred to as a PA, or a pancreas transplant alone, a PTA, which is rare. Very specific criteria determine when a pancreas transplant is appropriate. If you have any questions regarding pancreas transplant, discuss them with the doctors during your evaluation appointment. Chronic kidney disease is the slow loss of kidney function over time. Chronic kidney disease is also known as chronic kidney failure or chronic renal insufficiency. When your kidneys do not work correctly, wastes build up in your blood and they make you sick. The most common causes of chronic kidney disease are high blood pressure or high blood sugar, also known as diabetes. Kidney failure is defined when kidney function falls below 15%. When you are in kidney failure, you will have two treatment choices: to start dialysis or have a kidney transplant. Most patients experience an improved quality of life with transplantation compared to dialysis. On average, patients will live longer, approximately twice as long, after having a transplant than if they had stayed on dialysis. Some patients may be able to avoid dialysis by having a living donor transplant before they need dialysis. Some patients are not interested in pursuing either dialysis or transplant, choosing not to pursue treatment for their kidney disease. It is important to discuss this decision with a physician. Donated organs can come from deceased donors and living donors. Gift of Life is the organ procurement organization, or OPO, that coordinates deceased donors in our area. There are two ways donated organs are received from deceased donors. The first is called donation after brain death, or DBD, and occurs when the family chooses to donate their loved one's organs after a devastating brain injury from which their loved one is declared brain dead. The other is called donation after cardiac death, or DCD. In this situation, the donor has suffered a devastating medical event from which recovery is not possible. With the family's approval, the patient is withdrawn from life support and cardiac death will occur prior to organ donation. If cardiac death does not occur within a designated time frame following withdrawal from life support, organ recovery will not occur. Donated organs may also come from living donors who may be related or unrelated to the recipient. Some living donors choose to remain anonymous. All donors, deceased and living, are screened very carefully prior to donation. When a donated organ is offered to the transplant center for you, The coordinator contacting you will inform you of the information regarding the organ, and you have a choice to accept or decline the offered organ. Transplants using living donor kidneys last longer. On average, living donor kidney transplants last for 15 years, compared to an average of 10 years for a kidney transplant from a deceased donor. Living donor transplants can be done sooner than deceased donor transplants. The time to a living donor transplant is from 1 to 3 months. The time to a deceased donor transplant can be from 4 to 7 years. The sooner patients can be transplanted, the better their outcomes will be after transplant. Living donation increases the likelihood that a transplant will occur. Only about 50% of patients that are put on the wait list ever get a deceased donor transplant. Many patients die before an organ becomes available or become too ill to allow them to be a viable candidate. The risk of dying on the waiting list is approximately 8% every year. Living donors need to have a blood type that is compatible with the intended recipient. The positive or negative aspect of blood type does not matter in a crossmatch. The donor and recipient's blood are cross-matched to ensure the recipient does not react to the donor in a detrimental way. Since everyone's blood antibodies change over time, cross-matches are done routinely to ensure no detrimental reaction occurs. Surgery can be planned in advance around the donor and recipient schedules. Since obtaining an organ from a living donor may be your best opportunity, you will be encouraged to pursue this option. There are not a sufficient number of donated organs to transplant all the patients who need a transplant. Our paired kidney donation program offers new hope to patients needing a kidney transplant. Often, a patient who needs a kidney has a family member or a friend willing to donate one of his or her kidneys, but it cannot be done due to tissue or blood type incompatibilities. Paired donation seeks to match individuals who do not have a compatible donor or recipient with others in the same situation. If you and your intended donor do not match by either blood type or cross-match, you may benefit from the paired donation program. Altruistic donors come forward with an offer to donate an organ, often without an intended recipient. Altruistic donors receive no financial or other incentives to donate. Their offers stem from a selfless regard for the welfare of another. One donation can begin a chain of organ matches in the paired donation program that may allow for many transplants to occur. For example, one kidney is donated, and transplant 1 is matched and transplanted to recipient A. Recipient A had a donor who was not compatible, but now transplant 2 matches with and donates to recipient B. Recipient B had a donor who was not compatible, but now transplant 3 matches with and donates to recipient C. Recipient C had a donor who was not compatible, but now transplant 4 matches with and donates to recipient D. Recipient D had a donor who was not compatible, but now, and so on, and so on, and so on. The gift chain of donations continues as long as there are suitable donors and compatible recipients. Some donor kidneys are suitable for certain patients and can allow those patients to get a transplant sooner. Here are the criteria that have expanded the donor pool. Expanded criteria donors, or ECD. The age and health history of the donor and recipient are considered. Hepatitis B, core antibody positive. Recipients who have been immunized against hepatitis B or may have had an exposure in the past may be able to receive a kidney that is from a donor who has been exposed. Hepatitis C positive. Organs from donors who have been positive for hepatitis C may be transplanted safely to recipients who also have hepatitis C. Center for Disease Control. High-risk behaviors involve using donated organs from a patient with a history of one of the following: sexually transmitted diseases, high-risk sexual behavior in the last 5 years, injection drugs, having been in jail or a mental institution in the last 12 months. When the recipient is placed on the wait list, they will specify whether to consider organs from these types of donors. The coordinator will discuss this with you at the time of listing and again at the time of the offer. The recipient can then make an informed choice and can either accept or decline the organ offer.